Mr. Kumar, thank you for the warm up. It was fantastic. I myself look forward to that report that you just released. Fantastic, guys. First of all, a warm welcome to the panel. We have been, if we have to, kind of make a word cloud of the session so far today of what has happened on our session today so far. Cookies would be there like on font 100 because that's one word that that has been spoken about the most, right? So we are kind of taking that narrative ahead, as Mr. Kumar also said, and as Urvi just kind of opened the session of what happens when the third party cookies disappear. In today's panel, we have all key stakeholders, to kind of answer this and help us, navigate this, right? We have, Amit, who is, Vice President Marketing at Havells. He's the brand custodian at Havells, Amit Tiwari. Please welcome to the panel. We have Arjun Som, who is the founding member of Aeroscope, a tech provider, who kind of, brings all of this together. So would be very interesting to know his perspective on the entire cookieless world, as we want to call it. Abhishek Shah, pleased to welcome Abhishek on the panel as well. Abhishek is the head of marketing at BharatPay. And Sachin, who is the associate director and head digital transformation and marketing at PaisaBazaar. I would like to, request all our panel members to please switch on the cameras, and we can then start the session. Opening the first panel for the day today. Cookies, as we all of us know, that have been integral part of programmatic advertising for what now 20 years, right? But all of that is about to change. As all of us know, that Google just made an announcement, that they are going to block third-party cookies on their browsers, which is a significant step because they have close to 64% market share across the globe on all devices, right? So as I said, we have three large advertisers here, three large brands here, and a tech provider who would, bring all of that together on the panel, to kind of jumpstart this discussion, right? So first of all, I'd like to set the context by saying, to the audience who've joined us today morning, that all cookies are not bad guys. We still love the first party cookies, right? Because they love, marketers love first party cookies just because of the fact that it helps you personalize and hyper personalize, contextual experiences for people, right? Because it keeps some basic data of the user, like passwords and what they did, what section of the website, what they liked, and stuff like that, which helps brands to kind of make sure that they are serving personalized experiences when the user visits that websites. That's critical for us to understand that first party cookies is going to be there, right? And that's our first point of discussion today, right? As I kind of open up by asking Amit, right, from Havells, right, should brands now realize that you already have some data of the users because of the first party cookie that you have. Does brand realize that? And do you think that brands can leverage this first party data more, right, to serve better experiences and increase conversions for your customer? How would Havells, kind of deal with this, Amit?
So good morning, everyone. Hi, Jose. Thank you for a very, very well platform setting. I think that builds the context very well, the way you actually talk about. Coming to, I think, as a marketer for almost more than two decades, and if I actually see today, how does the entire ecosystem of cookies, and you rightly put it out, it's been 20 years, and the question is always whether this is right or what is wrong, and what is wrong and what is right. I think the situation today has gone beyond, and yes, the amount of first party cookies every marketer collects, and that's the need, not only from a remarketing tool as a per se, but also in terms of getting marketing insights. Because if you see today, marketing is also moving in more in terms of how you generate insights and how those insights can be done. The larger question, Joseph, is cookies are the only way to be dependent upon? I think no, whether it is first party or third party. There may be a traditional ways, but maybe things may be an old, but today in the today's context, contextual advertising, contextual targeting becomes much more better. Because you not only get apart from what you need to know from a consumer behavior pattern, the consumer digital journeys, as well as consumer decision journeys, but you also know what exactly is the way to, not only by targeting some limited targeted pages or some limited keywords, that makes a huge difference. Two things which is actually seen from the last couple of months, because of this Black Swan event, a lot of things have also changed from the perspective of how does the contextual marketing works and how does it can actually look in the entire target. First thing which is actually been changed is that today, the dependency on cookie is not something that any marketer is looking for. And since I am representing one of the marketing fraternity to look for, what people are looking for is behavioral trends. And that is what the new particular in-depth study, which has actually come, is netrography, which is also in terms of how does in a day in the life of a consumer, the entire internet habits and his particular preference moves across the spectrum. That is one. Second thing is there's a lot of researches that happen in metro markets and now in India also that some of the brands have started exploring, which is a semantic contextual targeting to look for, which can use deep learning algorithms, which actually talks about how does the behavioral pattern of any particular context can actually build. And that has very been successful. There have been some pilots which is happening in the entire space. So coming to the point that you actually raised and the question that we started discussing in the first particular question to look for, I think the world has actually moved beyond cookies. And I think it doesn't matter for whether it's a first party cookie or a third party cookie. The bigger thing which actually matters to it, the data that I'm actually trying to consider, the decisions which I'm making on the data is authentic. It is real, which actually gives me trends. It is not about something which has been generated just for the heck of generating the numbers to define that particular. That's how I think in this context, Joe.
Sure. Thanks, Amit. So what you're saying is, you know, first party cookie is there, okay, but brands would love to believe that they have moved ahead of first party cookies. You have more innovative ways, depending on, you know, software and platforms. You have more innovative ways of you know, harnessing data, enriching data of the consumer. It is not just about the quantity of data, it's the quality of data, right? Because today, as we you know, just the sheer volume of third-party data, right, makes the first-party data look, you know, very, very expensive, right? So we are also, you know, talking about, you know, Google has released the Google Privacy Sandbox, right, for example, where you can aggregate or bucket, you know, traits of consumer into broader, larger cohorts, if you may, right? And DMP platforms have also started innovating around, you know, the same area. So with that, it's a beautiful segue to kind of, you know, bring in Arjun, the founding member of Arascope, right, which is an ad tech platform. Arjun, you know, as an company, right, which is bringing all of this together for the advertiser and for the publisher, right, how would you kind of take this ahead?
Good morning, members of the panel and the audience. You know, thank you for pulling out time and joining us here today. And Jose, I think you've done a very perfect setup of the conversation, and hopefully we'll be able to inform everyone about, you know, what are the next steps and how to approach this particular hurdle that we are all going to face very soon. Now, the digital advertising industry owes a lot to the third-party cookies. Morning, all sir. The growth we have seen is mainly because of third-party cookies. You know, it enabled simple buying strategies like frequency capping, as well as complex strategies like dynamic creative optimization, essentially bringing accountability into digital marketing and accountability into every ad dollar that is spent. Now, at a very immediate level, once this was announced and Firefox and Safari already started blocking third-party cookies, we saw a 70% drop in CPMs for Safari and Firefox the next day, right? So that said, you know, third-party cookies were not a very sophisticated way of targeting, to be very frank, right? I mean, you may all have seen ads following you around even after you purchased the product, right? There was very little integration between the first party data and the third party cookie. But this brings us to a very unique opportunity as an industry to evolve into what we'll call the next phase of digital advertising, right? Now let's take an example. Now, supposing I'm in a mood to buy a new pair of headphones, or I'm looking to buy a big ticket item like a car, or, you know, I'm purchasing a home, or I'm you know, looking to figure out what kind of electrical equipment I want to fit in that home. The first place I go is the internet, to understand who are the providers, what services are available in the market, you know, what product should I go after. And using all of that research that I do, I take an informed decision. Now, this is called the digital influence factor. Now, Deloitte back in 2015 had done a study where it said that 21%, which is close to 60,000 crores of retail purchases, are influenced by digital factor, right? And this is back in 2015. Now those numbers will be significantly higher, right? Now, so what does this bring us to, right? So there's the first party data where a user comes onto a brand or advertisers or products website and leaves certain footprint in terms of what they're doing, comes to that website with a certain amount of recency and frequency, which indicates intent, right? The second aspect is, now he's come to the website. What about the users who have not come to the website, right? How do I figure those users out? So at Aeroscope, you know, we are trying to provide a product through which customer intent across the web can be isolated. And, you know, we are trying to marry the first party intent with the content consumption pattern of the user and trying to bridge the gap, right? Essentially place the product at the right point of time in front of the user when he has the intent of purchasing that particular product or service. Now, that said, there are significant challenges in achieving this. The industry has led towards an aggregation model, but this will cause a lot of, going back, and there will be multiple players, partners, tech providers who will have to come into some kind of an agreement, a global handshake per se, to enable us to achieve this. The good news is that once the cookies go away, like you said, Google will launch its privacy sandbox, which will provide open web standards, right? They will provide various APIs for tech providers, publishers, advertisers to hone into their APIs and be able to track users, understand behavior, understand content consumption, and create cohorts. So though the day of one-to-one targeting and retargeting will go away, the cohort-based targeting will be the new norm, is what I believe. And and every company today, whether it's a advertiser, agency, publisher, ad tech provider, should try and be at the cutting edge of this, you know, be ahead of what is going to come. And mobilizing a cohort, targeting them, linking them to the right product and service is where I believe the future lies.
Brilliant. That is really thought-provoking. Cohort is the way to go ahead, as we get into the future. Coming to you, Abhishek, because, you know, you represent the fintech industry, if I may, right? Use BharatPay as a fintech. It's obviously one of the largest one out there. Within fintech, the data privacy is much more a sensitive issue. You also have some kind of regulations, for your industry that is there. How would you say, a large brand like yourself within the fintech industry is looking at, making first-party cookie work harder, right? And still ensure that you're giving that comfort to the user or to the customer that they are in the driving seat, their privacy is taken care of, they need not worry.
Right. So, as a user, even I don't want my data to be shared with advertisers. I want my data to be private, only to me. Whatever I'm doing on the internet, I don't want the advertisers to access it. On the other side, the good part, like Arjun also shared, the good part is that we get tailor-made advertisements based on our own needs and wherever we are, right? So it's served at the right time with the right product, just when I actually need it.
Arjun, can you hear me or is it just me? No worries. So let's move forward. So I think he was trying to give us an industry perspective. I'm sure Abhishek will join back. So can I bounce off the same question somebody else in the panel? Sachin, can you jump in because you also represent another fintech company. Third-party cookies goes away. You can't look at behavior and other attributes of the user across the net, right? So how are you ensuring that for the advertiser, because that is the monetization model for a lot of companies here, right? For the advertiser, eventually, how are you making sure that they are getting their bang for the buck?
Yeah. So thanks for having me here. When we really talk about the cookie-less future, we are only talking about the third-party cookies. And one thing I would want to share that as a company, from day one, we were relying more on the first-party data than depending on the third-party cookies or third-party data available in the market. Obviously, as an advertiser, I'll have less, less option to do behavioral analysis. I'll have, less options to reach out to people who are in the market for a financial product. Maybe not directly, but maybe they are looking for, researching for a new car or maybe for a new house. So I would know that these guys might be in the market for a home loan or a car loan in future. I would lose that ability. But if you talk about as a consumer, if I give you a consumer perspective, it is always very scary when I have never been to your site, I have never interacted with any of your product, and suddenly I start seeing ads, which it's eerily, sometimes it's very scary that what is happening. So that it's a good step towards protecting the rights of a consumer. As an advertiser, I'll obviously, and since I come from a fintech, I come from a financial industry, the data is very critical. We have all sort of data. We have your scores, credit scores. We have your past transaction histories, etc. So it becomes more relevant for us, to protect that data. As long as the future of marketing is concerned, like I said, that we were relying more on the first party data, we have now a very efficient data lake in place in the organization. We have started working on that lake long back. So first party cookies are there. We are storing whatever is legal to store. We are utilizing that data in our not only in our advertising, but also in our product serving on the website. So just to give you an example, if you go to Paisa Bazaar, and I can proudly say that we are the first organization in the country where we are trying to analyze the chances of your approval when you apply for a financial product. Because unlike other products, if you want a financial product, you may not get one. It depends a lot on your financial standings, on your, sometimes on your social standings also, like all these new fintech companies, they're using your social data also to analyze whether you are a credit worthy customer or not. Right. So we have what happens most of the times, a naive consumer would go for a provider who is offering a loan or, a financial product at the cheapest interest rate, because they do not want to pay higher EMIs. But what happened most of the times, these organizations, they want the cream of the customer. You need to have a certain salary. You need to come from certain, employment sector. You need to be working with certain employers. You need to be living in certain areas. Only then you'll get that kind of an interest rate. So what happens when consumer apply for these products, they get rejected, and it has an adverse impact on their credit score, because every time you get rejected, your credit score goes down. So next time the chances are even more difficult. So we are trying to protect consumers from this type of situation, and telling them that this is the provider where you have the highest chances of approval. And we are doing it using the first party data we have. Another important thing, and it's very important for us advertisers, because sometimes we want to go beyond the first party data. We want we want to leverage someone else's data, right? Which in usual terms are called secondary cookies, where two organizations who have taken consent from the customers are agreeing to share data between them. Right? So I know that, let's say Car Dekho, I know people who are coming on Car Dekho, they are looking for a for a new car, or maybe a secondhand car, but they want to purchase a car, and they're very relevant for my auto loan product. Similarly, Magic Bricks or a 99acre, where I know that this audience is very relevant for my home loan product, or maybe a home loan balance transfer product. I can ask these organizations to share the data with me if they have the consent of from their consumers. And then I can, you know, create my own cohorts. Obviously, it will not be as advanced as these, you know, DMPs or other, you know, these advertising tools for offering, because they had a holistic view of the consumer. But, you know, in order to have a, you know, better future for the consumer's privacy, we have to compromise on something.
Sure, sure. So it's kind of a beautiful insight, Sachin. First of all, thank you so much. You're saying, you know, I loved, you know, of the consumer by ensuring that their applications are not being rejected. So following on that, you know, and maybe Arjun jump in as well. As Arjun said, do you think, you know, lookalike modeling, predictive data science, you know, techniques, right, can help the right consumer, right kind of credit profile of a consumer in the use case that you just said, to ensure that they are going to the right kind of credit, make sure that, you know, they are both kind of engaging with each other and the consumer interest? Is that something, you know, that, you know, advertisers be keen to know that you are actually going to the consumer and to the right first? And second, you talked about the data lake. So techniques like maybe, you know, implementing a CDP is something that, you know, customers, a lot of brands are kind of evolving now, right? And we will definitely segue into what you just said, right? Publishers are building their own data ecosystem, which is where you brought in the second party cookies, which is actually first party cookie for some other brand, right? That becomes second party cookie. So yeah, so fantastic. So how do you, you know, if you can quickly kind of look, you know, talk about, is there something else that, you know, advertisers can look at, right, when they come to platform like yours to make sure that they are looking at the right audience, you know, for, you know, targeting their messages?
Jose, like you mentioned that, you know, creating a lookalike segment, and it's currently, I understand that it's very important for an advertiser, because, you know, as an advertiser or as a marketer, I would always want to be present in front of the right consumer with the right messaging at the right time. I think these three are the, and obviously with the right product. So these 4 points are the four pillars of having a beautiful business proposition, right? So if I lose one of these, that I'll not be able to figure out the right time, you know, or I'll not be able to figure out the right consumer. Obviously, it'll have an adverse effect on my advertising budget and the efficacy of my marketing campaigns. It's something which I would be compromising. But like I said, right, you can enrich your first party data as much as you can. And it's good. So we had, you know, we had a law in place where we could not share the PII information of a consumer. I think it's there with most of the organization. You sign a whatever agreement you sign with a consumer, are never able to share your PII information. Now, the digital footprints are also being included in the same bucket. And, you know, it would be very difficult to share the digital footprints of a consumer without their consent. It's a good thing. It'll have some adverse impact on the advertisers in a short term. But we'll start focusing more and more on our own data, right? Which was not happening earlier. If you ask, and I do not have the right number, but I can you know, easily say that 70% of the companies, they do not have the right data infrastructure in place. They were relying more on these DMPs. They do not have anything inside because it's a lot of work, right? You know, maintaining the data, sanitizing the data, you know, creating the right cohorts within your ecosystem. You need a team of data scientists. You need some tech infrastructure. It's a difficult part, and obviously, it's a important and a very critical investment brands need to make in order to be you know, be able to serve the customers. When we talk about you know, the secondary cookies, which I would be going for, again, I'm sure as we evolve, there would be certain things which I, as the first party company who have collected the data, would not be able to share without the consent. And a consumer would know what I am sharing and what I am not sharing. What data is safe when they are signing up with me, what data I can share with other companies. So, you know, when everything is transparent, there are a very high chances that the customer would trust me more if I'll explicitly tell them that this is the data which I might share with the organization, and only to get you the better offers. Sometimes what happens, I'll give you an example. So in our home loan journey, most of there are a certain segment of people who come on the site just to know their eligibility. They have not identified the property. So we have two segments, whether you have an identified property or you are still looking for one, right? In any case, we'll tell you your loan eligibility. We'll tell you the options you have. But people who have not finalized a property, still looking for, still trying to figure out what their eligibility is, they're definitely in market for a new property. They're looking for a property as well. And simultaneously, they're checking their loan eligibility. If I have the right consent, I can share this data with, different real estate firms and tell them that these are the people who are looking for a property in this particular city. It's very enriching, but you need to know what you're looking for. Obviously the lookalike campaigns, they were the easiest way out. You just tell Google or Facebook or any third party retargeting platform that this is the audience profile. Please figure out where I can get them. Now that please figure out part is not there, so you'll have to work hard to get these customers to you.
Sure. Thank you so much, Sachin, there. I'll pick on the word to kind of segue into our second topic for the panel today, right? You use the word trust, right? So let that be the key word for us to jumpstart our second, question on the panel. So I see a big smile on Amit's face. So I'll start with you, Amit, right? So, as consumers are kind of, let's say the PDP has kicked in, the private, the Personal Data Protection Bill 2019, let's say that kicks in, right? And consumers are, are getting more comfortable that, their private data is protected. Once that happens, right, can we do kind of a crystal gazing here, right? And say, once the consumer is willingly sharing the data, right? Is there an opportunity for the publisher, the DSP, the SSP, the advertiser, the agencies, all of them to come together, right? And create an ecosystem, people call it as unified solution, for example, right? Is that, a trend that would emerge going forward when willingly consumers start sharing their data with the factor that they are trusting the entire ecosystem, right? The supplier side as well as the demand side, right? With their personal data. So what are your thoughts as a brand, as an advertiser, on universal identity solutions, which is emerging, as we speak, right? Because, people are consuming more content on OTT, on connected TVs, right? And digital outdoor advertising is on the rise. All of that kind of helps the advertiser to kind of attribute all of his efforts to a particular identity, right, of a user.
So, Joe, I think very, very well point picked up across from the discussions that actually came across. But I think there is, apart from the entire ecosystem, I think one thing that needs to do a step back, which is primarily to create a framework, which is a 3T framework, which actually starts with trust, transparency, and also in terms of technology role play. And it is very important to have an intermingling between the two. What happens today, and everybody's seen from last more than two decades for us, is that the first thing that actually goes for a deficit is the trust, because it goes from many circles. It actually travels many circles. The data travels many circles. You don't know, I have trusted you, you have trusted Sachin, somebody has trusted us, but you don't know how does this entire ecosystem can actually fall flat and what were the leaks can actually happen in any of the entire system to look for. If that can be built across, that's the first layering to actually start, and it'll give the trust to the consumer that, boss, I am 200% confident that my data will not move across. Today, I'll tell you, most of the places, and if you talk about today, after this COVID, there are 30-40% increase in the home delivery for foods and all. Anybody who even asks for a phone number, and people really hesitant to say, boss, I have signed it and I have paid from my particular XYZ wallet or UPI transfer, I don't want to share it. That's the level of deficit of trust which is already there. The people are fearing about even sharing a basic number from which they have called, which anybody can trace it from their particular call center. Second thing which comes is there any transparency? For example, I, as let's say a third party provider, I did a default. Can I just do an apology saying, boys, it's the mistake from my particular team, something, the data got. We don't have that particular ecosystems in place. We don't have that frameworks. Third is, how much is the role of a technology can actually look for it? If I put in 5 fields in my particular data as a consumer, and if I don't want to share next 3 fields, can it be possible? And that particular part of the technology can be in my hands. Or if I can get a particular warning says, you have shared the data on XYZ platform. Now it has been shared by this. Are you okay? Please apply and give your particular consent. It moves. So all these three, it's not only about trust. Joseph, if you see, it is not only about giving trust is fine. And that's the first thing that actually goes for a deficit. If you're able to being transparent, if you're able to have that particular courage and say, boss, yes, this is the transparency I'm going with. And if you can weave in all the two with the transparency, with the technology part of it, I think it gives a very, very robust system and it changes the system. It is not about, I have to be dependent. Somewhere the data have been stolen. Somewhere the data has not been stolen. Somewhere people have actually asked for it. Somebody's reselling it. We may call it in a different words or semantics, but end of the day, it's a data theft. End of the day, it's a loss of trust to look for. So any brand, any marketer will not really want to ride on a starting on their particular brand journey on a mistrust. And that is how I think it is very important for anything that you do. These first formulation of the framework has to happen.
Brilliant. I'll borrow that framework from you, Amit. The 3T, I love it. Transparency. Technology. Trust gives consent, and consent gives data for the brand. The user wants the brand to kind of be more contextual and personalized to him. That's the starting point. But technology, right? So how is technology bringing all of this together, Arjun? In terms of if we have to, be on Amit's 3T, right? How is technology enabling that trust to gain that consent from the user, so that all the brand engagements or interactions the user is having is more free, and he is completely at peace, and is that okay? I'm on the driver's seat. My data is not being misused. So how critical is technology in this?
Yeah, very good question, Jose, and thank you, Amit, for that insight you provided from the brand perspective. Now, to take a step back. The internet is largely sponsored by advertising, right? Hmm. All the knowledge we gain, all the movies we see, all the games we play is all sponsored by advertisers, right? Now, a few years ago, there was an ad blocking revolution, right? Which led publishers to push towards a paywall. Subscribe to me to receive my content, right? And
correct.
Taking OTT as the best case and news as the worst case, the paid subscriber base today is barely 3-6%, right?
Yeah.
So, and taking an advanced country like US, that same similar paid subscriber base would be 15-20%. So people still want internet to be largely free. They want to receive information free. They want to be entertained for free, right? So coming to privacy, this will further bolster publishers to ask for consent and get PII information, right? And secondly, with PDP bill going, whenever it goes live, users will believe that my information is being handled well and nobody is, playing with my trust, right? When I'm giving this information. And the third part is where advertisers, brands, agencies will all start building their CDP, right? Now, publishers have consent, have PII. Advertisers have consent, have PII. The technology players in between and the users have to ensure trust between these three parties. Now, this is where, we will have to strike a balance. And that's where technology comes in, right? Identity linking. Now, like Sachin said, now, if someone comes to purchase or purchases an auto insurance or checks out an auto insurance, may be interested in buying a car. Now, how do I transfer this information between two media buyers or media sellers in an anonymized way? Now that is where the role of technology is going to primarily come in, right? Now, resolution will be one of the key ways, right? There'll be various players in the market who will say that I provide identity resolution and I'll help you to communicate between your ad dollar and the final user. The second aspect that will also, take take off is publishers setting up their own private marketplaces, right? Because they will see a significant drop in ad revenues from programmatic, they will want to reach out to advertisers and say that I have the first party data, you have your first party data, I have a private marketplace where I can run your ads, and the accountability of the ads that you've run on my platform will be transparent to you through identity linking. So a technical handshake between advertisers and publishers is also something that we are foreseeing. So everyone is going to go a step closer. Publishers will go a step closer to the user by asking for consent. Mm-hmm. Advertisers will go a step closer to the publisher, saying that, can we have an identity link and essentially measure the attribution of campaign. In terms of agencies, now they will play a key role here, being the custodian of the advertising dollar in the market. They will push for the private marketplace because managing multiple platforms will become a severe headache for brands and advertisers. So the agency will have to bolster this and provide solutions and onboard partners, build own technology to help brands, advertisers, publishers to achieve this. So this is what I'm thinking is going to be the next.
Sachin, quickly your thoughts, because we have got enough questions here on the panel as well as on my WhatsApp group. So I'll quickly start. Let's start addressing that. So your last view from here.
Yeah. Like Arjun rightly said, it will be very difficult for an advertiser to manage so many second party platforms. So there is a huge opportunity lies ahead for especially for all these DMP providers or agencies marketing agencies basically to have a marketplace kind of a setting, which Arjun rightly mentioned. And as long as the role of technology is concerned, having everything together is something which can only be accomplished by using technologies, whether having the right data framework and whether having the right encryption in place, because when the onus is with you to protect the data and when it's your responsibility, you would want to have the world class infrastructure in place, because otherwise if something happens to the data which consumers have entrusted you with, your reputation will go down. So you'll have to ensure that the right security is in place, data is in the right format and with the right encryption. So whenever, even if you are sharing with someone in the form of secondary cookies, what are you sharing, whether you have the right consent in place? The second thing is, going forward, it will not be a blanket consent from a consumer, what we currently do. So we have a lengthy terms and condition form when we are asking from a consumer to fill up a lead form or going through a journey on a website. We just, give a small link most of the times. And I can easily say that 90% of the consumers, they never go through those terms and conditions. You mentioned something within the text that we'll do this with your data, we'll do this. And consumer usually, in a hurry to fill up the form or to complete the journey, they just say, okay, I'm okay with your terms and conditions. Going forward, it will not be a blanket consent. Going forward, it will be a very specific consent, like Arjun said. And, whether you want to share this, whether you want us to share your PII as well, whether you want to share your footprints on our site, whether you would like to. So like I mentioned that example, that people who are looking for a property in a particular city, I would have to specifically ask that this is our data, which we might share with an advertiser who might have relevant offers for you. Are you interested? Would you be interested? And if it's a genuine ask, if it's an honest ask, many consumer may say that, okay, I'm anyways looking for a property. I'm anyways going to different sites, giving in my details. I would be okay. Similarly, I'll just give you an example. Let's say I am browsing certain books on Amazon, right? Amazon might ask that since you are interested in this particular area, would you be okay if we share this data, especially your interest, with some other advertisers, with Netflix. So whenever I go to Netflix next, Netflix will start suggesting shows which are very close to my interest. So if I'm browsing business books, might be business documentaries, if I'm browsing fiction. They might give me something related to that. So it will be very convenient for a consumer. The only thing is that we ask and we need to have explicit consent from the consumer. Mm-hmm. And when it comes to managing multiple consents, right? It's not a one blanket consent that we'll share your data. It's like we will share this, we will share this. So I might say yes to one, no to other. So I don't want my PIIs to be shared with anyone if I'm going giving it to you. But I would be okay to share my interests.
Sure.
Someone else might be, might not be okay to even share their interests also with someone else. So managing multiple preferences, managing multiple consent, again, it can be done manually. So you'll have to have a right technology, right framework in place to, get all the data and then keep it in the right format with the right security.
Brilliant. Thank you. I love the use case, right? Basis the books that you pick, you get a genre on your OTT.
Yeah.
Fantastic use case.
So one last thing, which just came to my mind, maybe in future. So like Arjun said that it's everything, people would like to have everything free on the internet, be it a news, be it an article, be it a show. So, even Hotstar, Netflix, all these platforms, they have a free or a paid version. Netflix doesn't, I believe, but others, they have a free and a premium kind of a membership with certain checks. So going forward, more and more publishers and more OTTs and more content providers, they'll start using this. So either you give me consent or you pay me, right? Either I'll get the money out of you in forms of ads, and to run those ads, I would need these many permissions. If you give me these permissions, I'll show you my content. If you're not okay with that, I might not be able to show you my content. So maybe, more and more publishers will start adopting this kind of a model. If you want a cookie-less or if you want your data not to be shared with anyone, then you have to pay me certain premium.
Fantastic. Thank you so much for that crystal gazing session, Sachin, Arjun, and Amit.
Thank you.
So can we quickly get into Q&As, right? We have a question here saying, what is the best alternative to third party that is already available in the market? I think we've kind of looked at, I'll just refer to my notes here. We spoke about contextual advertising, which is all first party data, old technique, but still works fantastic. So why break something, that is working? That's something that people spoke about. We spoke about DMPs here, right? How would you enrich? The last topic that we just spoke about was universal IDs. How could DSPs, DMPs come together, and with no third party data have a common ID, right? Where, Sachin just gave that example of how, publisher could use, an ecosystem, a data ecosystem, right? And partners can come in, sync their data, right? With the same, unique publisher identifier. We spoke about that. Arjun gave some fantastic use cases around lookalike modeling, predictive data science techniques, which his own platform is capable of doing today. Abhishek started the discussion with, native advertising himself. Sorry, he couldn't, join back, some issues there. Amit, brought in, fantastic, kind of insights on how an advertiser would look at all of that. So that's what we discussed. Moving on to the second question from Sohail Nurani. What is a cost-effective way to find attributes of your clients without using third-party cookies? I think that's exactly what we just spoke about. How do you enrich the first-party data using the current technology that is available? Consent management is one of them. Jyoti Sharma, how scenarios of advertising will change on social media in cookieless world? Jyoti and people on the panel, please jump in. I don't think social media would have a challenge on cookie because, for example, if you're on Facebook, Facebook knows everything about you, right? What you're doing, what you're clicking, what you're sharing, what you're consuming. So, social media monitoring is one of the ways actually to kind of ensure that, brands and advertisers can leverage behavior of and traits of a user if you want to take it that way. We have... again, a question from Sohail. Facebook and Google offers opportunity to small businesses to access customer data, but in cookieless era, it is not possible for small businesses to set up their own infra. It's like pre-2000 era where only big corporates can hire agencies. How to deal with it? Arjun, do you want to take this? And Facebook and Google offers opportunity to small business to access customer data in cookieless era, but it's not possible for small businesses to set up own infra. It's like pre-2000 era where only big corporates can hire agencies. How to deal with it?
So I think, you know, as a tech provider, there will be various companies that will cater to both large and small businesses, right? And coming to Facebook, Google, et cetera, these guys already have PII information, right? So the key aspect is for a small business to be able to firstly harness their own first party data and then essentially understand what is the probability to buy for a certain pool of customers, what is the probability of churn for a certain pool of customers, and which product do I place in front of that customer in terms to improve my odds against 1 and 2. Now, this has to be communicated. So the cataloging, the product recommendation, and the cohorts that you create on your own data has to be pushed into platforms like Facebook, Google. And you cannot leave the decision on Facebook and Google to connect the user to your product. A lot of this decision-making has to be done by technology, either that you build in-house or you use a partner like us to help achieve this.
So I hope that answers the question. I would like to add something here and the past question also, how it will impact the social media advertising. So guys, we need to understand one thing. Whatever you are doing on these platforms, be it on Google, be it on Facebook, Twitter, TikTok, etc., whatever actions you are taking there, that's their property. They have that data. So if you are liking certain groups on Facebook, Facebook knows that you are liking these particular groups, you are consuming these sort of, right? And they're storing it and then modifying your wall according to that. They so advertising on Facebook would not change much because anyways, I am asking Facebook to give me audience basis their own first party cookies. So whatever you're doing there, this first Facebook's first party cookies and I'm buying that. Right, so that would not change much. So I think it should answer, be it a small organization or a big, if they want to leverage Facebook's data or if they want to leverage Google's data, you know, they would be able to do that in future as well.
Sure. Thanks, Sachin. We just have 5 minutes left. Sohail, we hope we have answered your question. And, you know, any small business should also, in my mind, focus on omni-channel or as I call phygital journeys, right? As you move into omni-channel journeys, you know, third-party cookies becomes irrelevant. So you can, you know, kind of do it on your own. We have Devjit Sen. How would you differentiate between CDPs and CIPs in terms of customer identity and data enrichment? Differentiation between CDP and CIP. So I think I'll take a stab on it. I think you know, both are data enriching platforms. The whole intent is to have single view of a customer so that the lifetime value of a customer once the customer comes in is more enriching for the brand. So that's what you know. I think we have just 4 minutes left. Maybe you know one more question. Vishal Mehta, why programmatic DMP with third parties unable to drive conversion? Programmatic DMP with third party data is unable to drive conversion. So it's quality of data. Yeah.
So one, it would be the quality of data, the kind of data they are gathering. The second thing is, you know, it's a very open-ended statement when you say that they are not able to drive the conversions. What are you looking at? If you only want bottom of the funnel consumers, people who would just come to your website and just purchase from you, it is very difficult. Most of the time, it's a journey, right? And goes from awareness to interest to finally conversion. So correct. How you, you know, handhold your consumer through this journey, it depends a lot on that.
Thank you so much, guys. We are out on time. If there are any more questions that you have, please leave it on the chat bot here. ETB would, you know, kind of try and get back to you. If you are registered already with them, the email IDs are there. They would, you know, kind of send back to you. And thank you so much for participating. Thank you so much, Amit, for fantastic insight. I love your 3T. You know, we will pick that up from there. Arjun, fantastic connecting with you. You know, your technology, you know, I was reading through is brilliant. We should, connect offline. Sachin, brilliant insights. You are a practitioner, a true practitioner. It all came from there. Thank you so much. And I'm sure we have close to 300 participants here. We added value to everyone. Thank you so much.
Jose. Thank you so much to you also. Lovely doing the fabulous way you actually connected with a lot of challenges. Thank you so much to you also. Fabulous interaction. Thank you, everyone.